Hello all, it's good to be here. We're a cozy bunch here in this little room. How many people have actually read the book already? Anyone have read the book? Okay, all right. And so.
I just bought it.
Oh, just look at the pictures. So you got a good idea there. Yeah. Well, my well-worn copy, my hardcover. This book, contains shocking facts about Canada's government, so it may not be suitable for new Canadians or those with a weak grip on their national identity. I thought the book was a brilliant idea, actually. I can say that because it wasn't my idea. It was the idea of a man named Jim Halley, a senior lawyer on the scene in Newfoundland who I worked with on some political campaigns, and he was a great strategist, great Newfoundlander. He was a junior lawyer at the time, in his early 20s. Only he was a law student at Dell. And he was in with the other senior lawyers and the politicians and saw how all this was done. He started the Union with America Party with Chess Crosby, John Crosby's father, and Jeff Sterling, who ran, of course, NTV and that empire later. But they were all very young men then. And they saw how it was done, and they were very frustrated by the way it was done. And over his life, Jim collected material about this event, historical material, documents. And he said, and then in the 80s and 90s, of course, the Canadians released secret documents. And then in the 90s and 2000s, the British started to release the documents. And so he started to collect these. And he said, look, it's all here. The whole miserable story of betrayal and infamy is here, laid out in their own words. It just needs someone, he said, to pull it all together for people, right? So that was my job. I knew what he was talking about right away. When we grew up, we had this instinctive feeling in our stomach that something was very wrong with the Confederation we had with Canada. We were treated with contempt by our rich, snotty relatives in Ottawa as they handed over the baby bonus check and pretended that they were our benefactors, but we knew that this was not the real story. And we didn't know exactly what had gone on, though. We couldn't put our finger on. So here it is in black and white. My job was to take thousands and thousands of pages of documents and boil them down to the relevant documents and most shocking documents that would tell the story in a nice chronological order, because it's a very complicated story. That was something that people could follow, get their head around. So it's not my opinion, even though I could hardly resist some comment. I did try to restrain myself. My editor tried to restrain me as well. So the result is a book of some restraint, which is not a bad thing, necessarily. And Jim Halley has his comments. I did extensive interviews with Jim, and so he is one of the local commentators on this. We have the Empire and the Canadian Empire and then other people. Hi, Kath, come on in. But primarily, Jim wanted this done. I don't know if I was the first guy he went to, but he was kind of a mentor to me and so he says all this to me, and he says, I'm too old. He said, I want you to write it. I knew it was a good idea. I could sense right away that, you know, what he was saying was true and someone should do this. And having nothing else to do at the time, I kind of went along with them, and I said, okay, let's just make a start anyway. And I did a bunch of interviews with him. Then he died. So there I am. I promised to a dead man, and I'm on my own. So I had to write the book. But it is primarily the story of Confederation. It is the story of Confederation from the British and the Canadian perspective, not the Newfoundland perspective. I don't discuss the failure of the Newfoundland political elite, so-called, to hold on to their government, and the campaign in Newfoundland to stop Britain and Canada. So it's not a judgment on Newfoundland's political culture. In the end, it's a judgment on the Canadian and British political culture, of course. So it's not a nationalist manifesto, even though it could be used as one, I suppose. It's not anti-Confederate, really. A lot of the people who were bitterly opposed to the process were Confederates and hoped that Newfoundland would join Confederation eventually. But they were bitterly opposed to the way it was done because it disempowered Newfoundland. So, I mean, Canada's a great country. This was just not one of its finest moments. And Canada has problems, I think, admitting its events that have, you know, brought with it shame or disgrace on the country, whether it's the Aboriginals and the native schools, you know, the boarding schools for native children, and the whole way we treat the Aboriginals. Canada has a sense of denial about that. We're never really able to take hold of it and do something with it. Same with the Newfoundland situation. Real denial about that. And the deafening silence from official circles when the book came out was enough to tell me that they were very uncomfortable with it, because the public reaction was overwhelming. I still get Facebooks every day on the book. I've had people call me up and say, Greg, I took the book out and read it over my parents' grave. And they would have been rolling if they had known what was going on. It would never have happened if they knew, if they could have proved all their suspicions all those years ago. And so, and I've had more than one, I've had three people tell me they've rode over their parents' graves. I don't know how many other people did it. But so I felt very privileged to be the one who got to do this in a way. And I felt a lot of kinship for that generation. They suffered so much. They suffered being called fools for letting their country go. They didn't let their country go. They didn't lose their country. The country was stolen from them by people with much greater power than them. But all their lives they lived under the shame of having been having given away their sovereignty. And they were a great generation. They fought the war, they fought for this with every, you know, bone in their body, and they had an honor, a sense of honor that generation did. My father, Jim Halley, all my uncles, and so many other people. So I really did it for them because in truth, there is sanity. All the humiliation and grief and pain and misery people suffered for that over the years, choking that down their craw, I felt it's time to at least tell the truth. In truth, there is a certain sanity. There's a refreshing sanity to know why the reason you feel the way you feel. And if you don't know that, then you doubt your own feelings and think you're going crazy. On a personal level or on a national level, it works. So for that generation, I wanted to set the record straight. And before the story was lost, I wanted to give it to the people who cared who are coming up. And the book really puts an end to the fantasy here of British fair play. They couldn't have been more unfair if they'd tried. And Canadian generosity. Canadians styled themselves as the savior of Newfoundland, saving us I don't know from what. From American prosperity or other fates that may have been in store for us. But Paul Bridle, who wrote an introduction to a big volume of Canadian documents, and he had been the acting Canadian High Commissioner in Newfoundland at the time. He was involved with everything. He knew everything that went on. And he wrote that in his introduction. He commended it to his friends in Newfoundland, with the hope that the truth that was in the documents, if it did not set them free, would at least give them food for thought. Now here's official acknowledgement that we were not set free, that we're still prisoners of some secrets of the past. And Paul Bridle was very troubled by it. I think that's why he went through such trouble to get the documents arranged and out before the British. So without further ado, let's take a little romp through history. Now, it's a very complicated story. I tried to make it simple. And it comes in three parts, really. The first part is, what happened? How did the British get control of Newfoundland anyway? Newfoundland was a dominion, like the Dominion of Canada, the Dominion of Newfoundland, the Dominion of Australia and New Zealand. What happened that the British got in 33? And why did they come in? Full scale, take over the whole caboodle. And so that's the pre-war stuff, all those dirty 30s politics. Of course, countries were losing their democracies all over the world, don't forget. You know, the British said they gave Newfoundland a rest from politics. This is what they started as, well, you know. The Germans were getting a rest from politics, too, with Hitler. Mussolini was giving the Italians a rest from politics, and, you know, democracy was under siege all around the world. In part, it was that sentiment that allowed them to do it, that you know, where the confusion of the 30s. Then we get to the war, and there's all of the intrigues in the war with Roosevelt and Churchill over Newfoundland. And then after the war's over, then there's the final dissolution and the final handover to Canada, the final betrayal. So it comes in really three sections. Now, if I go on too long, stop me. If you have a question, by all means, interrupt, because it's kind of a discussion and we need to kind of like, you know, feel our way through this. I'll try not to read too much. It's a different kind of book. I find it, let me start with Jim, okay? This is one of the stories that Jim told me that really got me going. It kind of hooked me in. Jim is a good storyteller, too. And this is what he told me. He said, in December of 45, when the big announcement came from London, I was a law student at Dalhousie University here in Halifax, Jim Halley told me. I and several other students were milling around the hallway talking about the great news in the paper from Newfoundland. Newfoundlanders to vote on the future government, it said. We were all very excited because we've been waiting for this for years. I and my friends had grown up under British rule since 34. Now it seemed we were going to get our government back, have elections, and get control of our own fate again. This was a great moment for us, and we were very optimistic about the future of Newfoundland in 45. The war had been good to Newfoundland. We were prosperous with so much American, Canadian, and British activity on the island during the war. Newfoundland was central to wartime and civil aviation, with two of the largest airports in the world at Goose Bay and Gander. The fishery was good, seemed that Labrador might hold vast mineral wealth and hydro wealth, so we were looking forward to a new and exciting future for our own country. There were several of us there talking about what it all meant, myself, Lloyd Soper, Abe Shipman, and George Hawkins, all law students. We talked about staying linked to Britain in some way, but mostly we talked about getting control of our own government back and becoming an independent country once again, as we had been for almost 100 years. Then George Hawkins interrupted us. Oh no, he said. Newfoundland is going into Confederation with Canada. The deal's already done. Well, we were stunned. I couldn't believe what he was saying to us. Oh yes, he went on. England sent people over from the Exchequer and the Dominion's office to Ottawa in October, and the deal is done. What deal? What are you talking about? We asked. Well, he said England is broke after the war, so Canada agreed to write off Britain's great war debt to Canada, give them a big loan at low interest, and in return, Britain agreed to work with Canada to put Newfoundland into Confederation. Well, I couldn't believe he was saying this. I mean, I just could not accept it. But I knew he wasn't lying. He knew what he was talking about because his father, Charles Hawkins, later a senator from Nova Scotia, was then a prominent member of the Liberal Party. Yes, said George, my father was with the team that negotiated the deal. It's all done. I was shocked. Surely I thought the British government would not do such a thing. They would not set up a national convention, which they had just announced the national convention to determine all this. They wouldn't set up a national convention in Newfoundland just for show. Surely there was still some chance for the people to have a say and to change that outcome. I returned home for Christmas, 2 days by steamer. I used to travel by steamer. Then it was great. All the talk in St. John's was about the coming national convention, but I could get no further information on what George Hawkins had said. Well, that's a long time ago now, said Jim, but what he told us that day has been on my mind ever since. I think of it all the time, and I want the people of Newfoundland to see how it was done, and I want the people of Canada to know, because I don't think they would approve of it any more than we did. So that was one of the truth, as so often happens, said Jim, is not commonly known. It sure is not. So that got me hooked. And I started to write. Now, let's go back then to just before the British came in and what they were coming into. Well, by the turn of the century, the 19th century into the 1900, Newfoundland was an autonomous country with a population of almost a quarter of a million. In 1907, at the Imperial Conference in London, it was elevated to Dominion status along with Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. And despite the huge sacrifices Newfoundland made during the First World War, the country enjoyed both good government and prosperity throughout the opening decades of the 20th century. It was the bank crash of 29 and the worldwide depression that followed that proved the country's undoing. Because there were only such a small population, of course, it couldn't hold out. So we turned traditionally we returned either to Canada or Britain in those kind of times when you had a long protracted crisis. There was one in 1894 or something. And for the backing to get through the hard times, well, Canada said no. And Britain said, all right, we'll do it, but we'll send over a royal commission. You'll have to accept whatever terms we lay down. So the Royal Commission came over, and it slammed the country. Alexander Clutterbuck wrote it for Lord Amelry, and there was some Canadians on the thing too. And Clutterbuck's report, written in colorful language by official standards at the time, gave the British government every pretext it required to resume direct control over the island. The Newfoundland financial crisis, he concluded, was not the fault of the depression and the collapse of fish markets, but the result of corrupt and venal politicians. He continued, there is no leisured class, and the great majority of people are quite unfit to play a part in public life. The so-called modernization of politics and the introduction into political life of men who sought to make a living out of their political activities has been responsible for this deplorable state of affairs. So he recommends getting rid of the government in Newfoundland altogether, putting in commissioners from Britain and a few from Newfoundland to make it look good, and a governor and be run direct from Britain. Absolutely no representative government at all. Now this drastic course, recommended by the Amelry Commission and Clutterbuck who wrote it, was not their invention. When he returned to Newfoundland, Clutterbuck and Amelry, when they came back to London, they found that everything had been carefully worked out between Neville Chamberlain, we remember him, at Treasury, and Edward Harding at the Dominion's office. These two men informed Amelry and Clutterbuck what the key points would be in the report. Now, when the Canadians read it, they were horrified. Charles McGrath read the draft, and he objected strongly to what they were saying about Newfoundland, that they had painted such a black picture of Newfoundland politics and politicians. And he said, "Who can throw the first stone at Newfoundland?" he said. "There's not a province in Canada or a state in the Union that has lived within its income. I seem to recall the May Commission in UK found that country guilty of extravagance which threatened the ruin of the country. And as for Britain's refusal to allow Newfoundland to default on its war debt," he said, "practically every country in the world today is in financial difficulties. Some have defaulted on their public obligations. In none has it been found necessary to send in the sheriff." He said, "The criticism of Newfoundland is apparently exaggerated for the purpose of building up a case for extravagant remedies and the substantial reversion of Newfoundland to a crown colony." But of course, Canada wasn't going to put in any money to help Newfoundland, so these boys had no one to back them up. Britain softened some of the language for the Canadians, and then the boys were forced to sign, and Newfoundland lost his government. The Prime Minister of Newfoundland had the gun to his head. So that was it. Newfoundland was gone. Now, that story, you would think, is not very well known. But in 2003, I read a report online in The Globalist, which is a magazine devoted to international affairs and IMF and all that kind of stuff. And this is David Hale writing the feature article for the magazine that day. gave this perspective on Newfoundland crisis of 1934. He said, the most extraordinary debt restructuring of the past of the pre-1945 era was not in Latin America. It was in a dominion of the British Empire, the country of Newfoundland. During the early 30s, Newfoundland experienced a form of political punishment and national humiliation for its debt problems, which is unsurpassed by any other country since the emergence of government debt markets in the 17th century. The Royal Commission's report and their proposed solution to the crisis has no parallels in any other sovereign debt restructuring. The notion that a self-governing community of English-speaking people, is very, those days, should give up both democracy and independence in order to avoid debt by default was unprecedented. If the IMF had existed in 33, it would have granted emergency debt relief to Newfoundland, and the country would have never given up democracy or independence. Indeed, democracy is now a precondition for IMF aid. This story is a reminder why, in the aftermath of World War II, nations of the world created the International Monetary Fund. They didn't want nations ever again to confront the choice between debt and democracy. Now, the Newfoundland debt, half of the Newfoundland debt, was the war debt that they had incurred voluntarily to pay for the war, to go over to Britain, to fight for Britain in World War I. Britain said, no, you can't reschedule it from 5% to 3%. We won't let you do that. But as soon as Britain took over, they rescheduled the debt for themselves down to 3% and carried on. Why did they do that? Why? Well, by the end of the First World War, Britain realized that its supremacy in transportation and the era of the great cruise ships was over. At the end of the First World War, they started to fly planes, right? At the end of the war. Air travel, they realized, would replace steamer travel. And if Great Britain wished to retain its superiority, it must somehow take the lead in aviation. In 1919, the English team of Alcock and Brown, flying out of Leicester's Field in St. John's, was the first to make the transatlantic hop successfully. The prize of £10,000, or $50,000, a fortune in those days, was put up by Lord Northcliffe, the owner of Britain's Daily Mail. But it was presented by Winston Churchill, then Secretary for Air in Lloyd George's government. They didn't know what to call it then. It was Secretary for Air. So he was like, Britain had its eye on Newfoundland. And once the commission of government was in place in St. John's in 34, they immediately began to construct the largest aerodrome in the world at Gander. According to Halley, everyone knew what Britain was up to and why it wanted Newfoundland. The Amillary Commission had foreseen a great British rebuilding of Newfoundland, a bastion, British bastion in the North Atlantic, you know. And they had many development plans for the island. But none of these plans came to anything. In fact, unemployment and poverty increased under British rule. The Newfoundland airport at Gander, however, was completed and operational by 38 at a cost of £900,000, or almost $5 million in those days, a huge expenditure in the middle of the Great Depression. It gave Britain instant superiority in transatlantic civil aviation. Their imperial gambit had worked. So that's why they were in there. Now, then comes the war, and we're to phase two. They're in Newfoundland, then we get into the war. Of course, very shortly into the war, Britain is blockaded by the Germans. Nothing can get in. But by the grace of God, they have Newfoundland, the back door, an escape hatch. And Newfoundland becomes the other point of this convoy route. And the Americans, of course, and the British become very paranoid as the war creeps on, that U-boats are coming across the Atlantic. They think that this whole thing might come across the Atlantic. And they're not prepared for it. So they... Canadians pour $5 million into the island. The Americans come in to the tune of hundreds of millions. And Churchill wants to get them in. Churchill wants to get Roosevelt in. And so to get the destroyers and the planes and stuff he needs in the meantime, he offers them Newfoundland territory as bases, which the Americans want. They want to move all their fortifications out front on the headland of North America, and Newfoundland is 1,000 miles closer. So they want to get everything out there. So they built five of the largest bases outside the states are built in Newfoundland. They have complete jurisdiction. And there's a huge uproar in Newfoundland against this. Britain, an unelected government, is giving away territory. You know? So Churchill is forced to intervene and write a letter to the paper in Newfoundland begging the people to accept this. I'll read you his letter. I would only ask, why not, eh? The people of Newfoundland, on whose loyalty we have in this testing time as throughout our long and eventful history, had ample proof to bear in mind the wide issues which hang upon this agreement. It is with these considerations in mind, recognizing to the full the considerable sacrifices made by Newfoundland to the cause which you all have at heart, and her splendid contribution to the war effort, we ask her to accept this agreement. It will be yet one more example of what she is ready to do for the sake of the empire, of liberty, and of the welfare of all mankind. Very Churchillian. Who could refuse the boy, huh? Of course, it wasn't written by Churchill. It was written by Sir Charles Dixon at the Dominion's office, who was one of the but anyway. He got his way. They got in. Now, in these situations, it was the two commissioners from Newfoundland who were sent over to talk to Churchill. Anything that was difficult at all in Newfoundland to handle, they gave to the Newfoundland commissioners. They would put them out front. You sell this to the population. The British commissioners couldn't do it. So this was the job of the Newfoundland commissioners. It was to sell every unpopular policy that the British came up with. So,
who were they?
Who was what? Penson, who was it? The commissioners had, The commissioners had no choice but to bow to Churchill's eloquent appeal and accept the agreement. They could do no more. But as Peter Neary records in his monumental work on the Commission of Government Years, great book, Emerson and Penson, they were the guys, were to leave the British capital fearful and bitterly disappointed men. So they got rid of the Riot Act in London. We only saw the eloquent tail end of it. So the Americans are in. The Americans come in, $100,000. They build hospitals and bases quicker than a wink. Like the Canadians have a fit. Here they are, with jurisdiction over massive parts of Newfoundland, complete jurisdiction, 20,000 men in, soldiers. If this goes on, it'll be American in no time. So the Canadians flip. And they immediately get together their act and send off a high commissioner. They'd never had a high commissioner in Newfoundland before. They didn't have anyone in Newfoundland before. Suddenly, Newfoundland has lost its constitutional status, and they send their top diplomat, Charlie Burchill, over to Newfoundland as high commissioner. So all the way through the war, you have this tension between the British and the Canadians in Newfoundland, and the British and the Canadians in Newfoundland. Who's going to, you know, who's going to win Newfoundland, basically, in the end? Well, things become stressful in England, and the British government, actually in St. John's, suggests that, well, let's give Canada control of the British bases, because there's British bases, there's Canadian bases, and there's American bases in Newfoundland. The place is a fortress, you know? So we can't hang on here. The money we're getting from London is not enough for us to oversee all this. Let's just give the Canadians the bases to run during the war. Well, no siree. Even though, of course, before Britain took over, it was always their policy that all of British territory in North America would come under Canada. The British North America Act foresaw that, and that was put in place for Newfoundland or any other territories to become part of Canada. And that was their long-range policy. But now it has completely changed. And when they requested that their own British government, Newfoundland, requested that the Canadians be given the authority to run the bases, this is what they got back. Secret, confidential. We have always understood that it was the decided policy of HMG, Her Majesty's Government, in the UK that Newfoundland, the oldest British colony, should remain a separate entity and should not be absorbed by Canada. That policy has certainly governed our actions in regard to the provisions of aerodrome and marine airbase facilities in Newfoundland since I first went there for preliminary talks in 1933. At that time, which was shortly before the Commission of Government was established, the local Newfoundland government was about to conclude agreements with Pan American Airways, under which the latter would obtain certain exclusive rights for aviation services in the island. I was just in time to stop all this. We have spent large sums of money for the provision of an airport at Hattie's Camp, which was Gander's old name, and also on the Marine Air Base at Botwood and on ancillary services. I think that it would be a great mistake to hand over the airports to the Royal Canadian Air Force for the duration of the war. It is one thing to let them in, but it would be quite another thing to get them out. Newfoundland is destined to play a very important part in the operation of the transatlantic services, and it is an important bargaining counter which would be folly for us to pass over at this time. So there it is. The statement of why Britain came in the first place is revealed in this response, of course. They're in for air supremacy. And that's why they want the Canadians kept out. So it's interesting to see. This is the same reason that Britain gave us Dominion status in the first place, was to keep Canada out. Because if Canada had been a Dominion and we had been a colony, that absorption would have been easier. But making us a Dominion along with Canada built a fence around Newfoundland so the British could invest, have their money there, and have a little place of their own in the North Atlantic.
Excuse me, I must have missed something. The Brits wanted the Americans in, so they brought them in.
The Americans wanted in.
Yes, but the British, they supported that.
The British allowed that, and the Americans gave them destroyers and airplanes and all kinds of stuff to carry on the war. Because Roosevelt couldn't get in the war right away, but he wanted to help Churchill.
Yes.
And so he had to get some quid pro quo.
Okay.
And the quid pro quo was all the territory in Newfoundland. So then we'll give you a basis for that, right? So the Canadians tried to get Goose Bay. Britain said, no, you're not getting Goose Bay. St. John's was up in arms about giving a 100-year lease on Goose Bay to the Canadians. But then the Canadian ambassador, Robertson, writes and says, look, if we don't get Goose Bay, you don't get your foreign aid package that John Maynard Keynes had just requested from us. So, so they got Goose Bay.
How did Goose Bay appear on the scene?
Goose Bay, there were two prime sites for airports on the East Coast. And at that time, you had to be either, to make the transatlantic hop, you couldn't do it from Halifax because of the fuel and everything, Newfoundland being 1,000 miles further out. So one of them was at Gander and the other one was at Goose Bay. These were identified as the two prime aerodrome facilities, right? And the British planned to do something in Goose Bay. They had something there, but the Canadians wanted to go in and make it their main base of operations against, for the war. And they wanted the same deal that the Americans had. They were very jealous of what was happening with the Americans, so they wanted to have the same deal. So, now where are we? Okay, so all during the war, there are debates in the House of Parliament over in London about this, saying, why aren't we giving the government back to Newfoundland? What's going on over there? They send members of the House of Parliament, a whole team over to go around Newfoundland. Then Attlee comes over, Clement Attlee, who later becomes Prime Minister, but he's in Churchill's war cabinet. He comes over, and they're saying, what are you all doing over here? Why don't you just give us back our government? That's what they want. Attlee decides we need to hold on. We should hold on to Newfoundland. We can't give them back their government yet, especially not during the war. So he takes this message back to Churchill. So what we get is a huge debate going on in London. It is, where are we? I'm looking for Beaverbrook. Here's Beaverbrook. Beaverbrook was a great friend of Churchill's, and he was now Minister of Air, and Air Supply, the new Ministry of Air. He was now the new Minister of Air. Churchill was his good buddy. Beaverbrook was, from New Brunswick. You know Beaverbrook, thing. And a great champion of empire, big news baron over there, and he was in British government about 50 years. Very colorful character. So the cabinet divides between Attlee and his crowd at the Dominion's office, and Beaverbrook and a bunch of other guys, and then Churchill, Churchill's in the middle. At this time, the autumn of 43, the war cabinet was meeting in underground bunkers. Bombs were falling overhead, and the outcome of the war was still very uncertain. Nevertheless, Lord Beaverbrook was very uncompromising in his condemnation of the commission of government in Newfoundland. He files a report to Churchill and the cabinet, which is very fascinating for what it implies about the reasons for the British takeover of Newfoundland in 1933. And it's a powerful indictment of British policy on the island. Here are the highlights of it. Beaverbrook comes in, slams his fist on the table and said, look, Newfoundland should be offered the right to resume dominion status right away or at any time during the war. He said, the claims put forward that the present commission of government is unconstitutional and its acts will be challenged. He said Newfoundland has lent us $8 million, most of it interest-free. It's given $500,000 to the Spitfire Fund for the purchase of aircraft, and it has provided another $150,000. Agitation in Newfoundland for the restoration of self-government is widespread. All the newspapers are full of it. Newfoundland public is entirely dissatisfied with the commission. The unpopularity grows daily. The Board of Trade is constantly asking for representative government. The claim that Newfoundland government fell through corruption is now accepted by no one. It's believed that the measure was taken to benefit the bondholders and supply the Canadian banks with repayment on their overdraft. In fact, it's believed that the Canadian banks actually helped precipitate the financial crisis in the first place. He said, the advantages of restored dominion status are manyfold. It'd be a protection against Canada's unjust claim over Goose Bay and the pretensions which the United States will advance in civil air bases in Newfoundland. With dominion status, Newfoundland will safeguard our imperial interests in the Western Atlantic against any ganging up by Canada and the United States, always a possibility under a different government. So here they are, there was divided down the middle there, which is nice to see that someone had another view over there. But Beaverbrook was kind of out of step. At this time, there were so many agreements being forged between Britain and the United States that they couldn't have that kind of isolationist policy, which is basically that what he's talking about here. So Beaverbrook was overruled, and they hung on to Newfoundland and held their nose and hung on to Newfoundland. Beaverbrook said, we are in an illegal position in Newfoundland, he said. We are unconstitutional, and it's illegal, and it will be challenged later. So he had given his warning. So finally, we get to the end of the war. And the Dominion's office, which runs Newfoundland, has a plan because, of course, everyone's looking at Newfoundland, the Canadians and the Americans, and the British haven't done a thing. They've had a dictatorship for 10 years. They have done nothing on the island. So the boys get their act together pretty quickly, and they plan $100 million for Newfoundland. They're going to rebuild Newfoundland, and all this is going to happen. But the war's ending, and England is broke. Broke. So John Maynard Keynes, the old man himself, steps in and says no to it. We can't hold on any longer, he says. And so you get this a change of attitude in the Dominion's office. And here's what they write from the Dominion's office when John Maynard Keynes comes down on them. He writes back, Dear John, I am under increasing pressure from Parliament and from Newfoundland itself to follow up on our main statement of policy made with the approval of the War Cabinet as long ago as December of 43 by announcing the government's detailed proposals. I skipped the page. Okay. And pressure is likely before long to reach formidable proportions, especially now that the new colonial development and welfare bill has gone through the House of Commons. Whatever our short-term dollar position, however broke we may be, parliamentary and public opinion would, I am sure, never accept a situation under which Newfoundland, alone of the dependent empire, was to be promised no assistance for reconstruction and development, and in spite of the very special obligations which we have assumed for her welfare. But the reply from John Maynard Keynes was not encouraging. So at the end of the war, with Britain broke and the states in a position of ascendancy on the island, the Canadians begin to make their move because they know that Britain is planning some constitutional change for Newfoundland. So the Canadians, they start to make their move. And they meet up in San Francisco at one of the post-war conferences on finance. British are there, Canadians, everyone's there. And so Hume Wrong, Hume wrong from the Canadian External Affairs is there sitting with Lord Cranborne from London. And this is what he writes. He writes back to Ottawa. He said, "When sitting next to Lord Cranborne at dinner last night, the conversation turned from the problems of Palestine and India to the problems of Newfoundland." And he agreed with my remark that Newfoundland was the problem child of the empire.
So this is
their attitude. So he talks to Cranborne, and it becomes obvious that the Canadians are interested, and it becomes obvious that the Canadians don't want any money spent in Newfoundland. So the department in London writes back, "We are committed to press our proposals, nevertheless, with Treasury and get money for Newfoundland, pointing out that His Majesty's government have assumed special responsibilities for the welfare of Newfoundland, and that difficult as the position may be, the one thing that is clear is that we cannot run away from this responsibility, nor indeed will Parliament and public opinion allow us to do so." So it's very tense in London, but he says, Newfoundland, we cannot run away from this. This is exactly what they will do, of course. It's great to read this. Almost all of the official documents, if you reverse what they're saying, you get the outcome. Everything, you know. So the British decide that they better meet with the Canadians. And John Maynard Keynes tells them, you've got to get this deal with the Canadians. Attlee says, well, the late Prime Minister Churchill, Attlee's just become Prime Minister, right? Always thought we should deal generously with the Newfoundlanders, the amount required for them being a drop in the ocean of our own liabilities. Well, it remained to be seen whether Newfoundland would get that drop in the ocean. A key moment in the fate of the province had arrived. Wrong's meeting with Lord Cranborne in San Francisco had a stimulating effect on the Department of External Affairs in Ottawa. And on September the 25th, 1945, Norman Robertson wrote another long memo to Scott MacDonald, the Canadian High Commissioner in St. John's, on the pros and cons of the coming union. Robertson noted with some unease that, quote, individualism, sensitiveness to criticism from outside, and a general backwardness of outlook are moreover strongly marked characteristics of the islanders that would not make for tractability or their easy assimilation into the Dominion of Canada. As always, the downside of the Confederation equation was the Newfoundlanders themselves. But despite these grave concerns, and after a review of Canada's defense position on the island and the resources involved in Labrador, Robertson brought himself around to MacDonald's position. Quote, it is possible, he said, that we should take the initiative ourselves rather than leave it to the Newfoundlanders. And so they start to set up political teams in Newfoundland and organize up and look for agents in Newfoundland who can infiltrate, sit on this national convention that the British have planned. Now they're going to set up a national convention, the first elections in Newfoundland since 1933. It's about 15 years later. So they're going to set up a national convention and people can run for that and be elected. It was given no power. It was to discuss and determine what types of government the island would be suited to. Self-government, get their constitution back and carry on as they were before. Or what? There were talk of being like Northern Ireland. We'd elect MPs that would go to London and we'd be just like Northern Ireland. They ruled that out. And they would not allow any discussions with the Americans. The only thing left was Confederation from Canada. And that was the whole point of setting up the National Convention, to get the Newfoundlanders to bring it in, to bring it on the stage. Go ahead.
I still don't understand how they gave up all of their democracy in 1933.
In 1933, we were in debt and could not pay, and so we were threatening default on our... No.
Absolutely nobody would come.
Britain came, but the price was we'll take over direct control.
Completely.
They wanted to do what they wanted on the island, basically, with air facilities and other stuff like that. Okay. So that was their thing. And it was condemned at the time. They asked, there were great debates in Parliament over in England and over here. But over here, after the First World War, we had lost a lot of population, and then a lot of expenditure on railroads and stuff. And the debt grew to a point where governments weren't handling it very well. There were about five governments in about 10 years or something like that, you know. And so Newfoundland was basically forced to either take it or go insolvent, and then there would have been another list of consequences to that, which would probably have been very difficult to handle as well. So they were able to do it. Yes. So now it gets very cloak and dagger. They have to keep all this from the Newfoundlanders. This whole negotiation to hand over Newfoundland to Canada has been kept from the Newfoundlanders while they pretend that it's up to the Newfoundlanders themselves at the National Convention. This is all going on. The National Convention sends a delegate to London, and they don't have a hotel for them. They're asked to bring their own towels. Own towels to London from St. John's.
How do you know that information?
That's from the guys who went on it, you know? Yeah. Lord Addison was the Dominion's office was totally frosty. They had to every question had to be written out and given in written form and getting back written answers. It was really the cold shoulder, and the Daily Mail in London like fumed about it and you know condemned the government for the treatment of the loyal Newfoundlanders, our friends, our relatives from Newfoundland. All this kind of stuff was going on, but they didn't want to give them anything, and they didn't want to let on. And they said they had no preconceived. They were asked point blank, what's your plans? They said, we have no preconceived plans at all. No preconceived plans. This is totally open. Of course, they were just about inking the documents with the Canadians at the same time. So they were completely, completely deceived.
Right. I missed something between Britain not wanting Canada to have
yeah.
And suddenly being in cahoots with them.
Well, they tried to hang on. To build up this British bastion and have their little piece of real estate there, right? You know, and so they could be in with Canada's States. But they were broke after the war. They had absolutely no Canadian dollars at all left. And Canada was giving them food and giving them stuff on credit to keep going. So they couldn't very well take their few Canadian dollars that they had and spend it on Newfoundland when they owed it already to Canada. They were in hock to Canada. And so John Maynard Keynes, the financial guy, says, it's over. It's over. That dream is over. Yeah.
Did the Americans not pay Newfoundland something for the airports and all that?
Oh, they paid a lot. They paid a lot. Newfoundland came out of debt within 2 years of the Americans being there. The government was running surpluses. The place was booming.
What happened to the money?
The Canadians got a lot of the money because their banks were in Newfoundland did the exchange. And the British got foreign currency reserves out of it too. The British convinced the Americans to pay the Newfoundlanders less because they didn't want it to look so bad that the British wages were so much lower than the American wages, so they got the American wages lowered. Another boon. Each of these periods is filled with so much intrigue and so many, you know. But finally, they're getting down to it. On September the 10th, Prime Minister Mackenzie King alerted the Canadian High Commissioner in St. John's, to the coming negotiations with Great Britain. Secret, confidential, Prime Minister writes, the United Kingdom High Commissioner here in Ottawa has asked us whether we would be prepared to hold very confidential and informal discussions on matters relating to Newfoundland with Mr. Clutterbuck of the Dominion's office, who could arrive about the middle of the month. This is agreeable to us, and it will be convenient for you to time your visit to Ottawa from St. John's accordingly. Ostensibly, his mission would be for other purposes, and therefore, this information is for you alone. The note back from London to their High Commissioner in Ottawa is equally conspiratorial, secret, confidential. Clutterbuck is arranging to cross by bomber 14th of September to Montreal. Grateful if accommodation can be arranged for him. It is excellent that Canada's High Commissioner in Newfoundland will be in Ottawa at the same time. But we're very nervous that it will come out in St. John's that Newfoundland is under discussion. We trust, however, that Canadian authorities will have impressed on their High Commissioner the importance of saying nothing, even in governmental quarters in Newfoundland, which might disclose the object of his visit. You should know that we have been very careful not to give even the government of Newfoundland any inkling of Clutterbuck's impending visit or its object. These top secret memos mark the beginning of the high-level cooperation between Britain and Canada to bring Newfoundland into Confederation without the knowledge of the people of Newfoundland. The conspiratorial tone of these communications indicates that all parties involved were well aware that they were initiating confidential negotiations that were constitutionally, politically, democratically, and morally wrong. They were certainly against the spirit and letter of everything the British governors were telling the people of Newfoundland, and was also contrary to the much vaunted Atlantic Charter, setting the rights of all peoples to self-determination, which the British had proclaimed with such fanfare in 41. Let's go back there for a minute. Shortly after the war started, Churchill and Roosevelt meet in Newfoundland, in Argentia, just off the coast there. And Roosevelt says to Churchill, well, first of all, Churchill wants Roosevelt in the war. But Roosevelt can't come in the war to fight for the British Empire. The Congress and the American people are not going to go to war to fight for the, to hang on to the, there's got to be a reason for Roosevelt to go to war. And it's freedom. It's always a reason for America to go to war, is freedom. And so what will we produce? What can we issue as our joint statement, our mission here, right? And so, well, it's the freedom of people to choose their governments. It's self-determination. You can't just walk into Czechoslovakia. You can't just walk in to Newfoundland. Here they are, sitting in recolonized Newfoundland. Now, Churchill didn't want that. He wanted the British Empire. He didn't want to give self-determination to India any more than he did to Newfoundland. Newfoundland any more than India or Palestine. He wanted to hang on to it all. Democracy is fine for white people, in, you know, English-speaking people, and you know, but not for the whole world. So he knew Roosevelt needed it. So they never signed it. It was never signed. People think it was signed. It never was. It was proclaimed. They proclaimed the Atlantic Charter, but they didn't sign it because Churchill wanted a way out of it. And they were sitting in Newfoundland, which he wanted to hold on to and keep colonized. He didn't want. So they proclaimed this document in a place that has just been stripped of its democracy and humiliated. But that was lost under weightier concerns. That irony was lost under weightier concerns. So back then to the National Convention. The National Convention goes through all its things. And Joey Smallwood, of course, is the Canadian agent working with Scott MacDonald, the Canadian High Commissioner. And he's ramping up every day, Confederation. He's not letting them do their work to go through the finances, to discuss other forms of government. It's Confederation. Joey takes over the National Convention just about. But nevertheless, after their trip to London and their trip to Ottawa, where they're received with joy bells, and you know, all the government ministers come out to meet them and everything like that. Nevertheless, the National Convention goes back, and after acrimonious debate, they decide, no, we do not want Confederation on the ballot. It is wrong to put Confederation on the ballot. The terms that the Canadians have sent down are no good. They won't work. And everyone afterwards realized that they weren't any good. So the National Convention says no to a Confederation on the ballot. We want the return of responsible government. This is our conclusion after a year. Roosevelt said to Mackenzie King that you can take over Newfoundland. We'll leave it as a British matter. But he said, Newfoundland, he said, Roosevelt said this to Churchill, he said, Newfoundland cannot remain independent after the war. They were paranoid about what had happened during the war, and they didn't want to leave. They just invested hundreds of millions. They wanted to keep a lock on it in case there was Russia, whatever might happen after the war. They didn't know, but they were quite paranoid at the time after having gone through World War II, you would be. So he said, after the war, he said, Newfoundland cannot go its own way. You can't get independence back. It either goes with you, Britain, or it goes with Canada. And if you fuck it up, we're here, right, you know? But we leave it as a British matter. That was the understanding that Mackenzie King had in his diaries. He records that. So how do you do that? How do you guarantee that? You can only guarantee that by fraud. That's the only way you can guarantee that. You know, you don't know the result of the election until it's done, unless you have fixed the result of the election. So Jim writes, "We rejoiced when the National Convention rejected Confederation as a choice on the ballot paper and recommended just two, responsible government or commission of government. We thought we'd won and shown Great Britain that Newfoundland didn't want Confederation, or at least not through a referendum run by the British and the Canadians. The Canadian government's terms had been debated thoroughly in the National Convention and found to be seriously flawed, which became obvious to everyone later on. The convention therefore decided wisely not to submit Confederation on the basis of those terms to the general public in a simple referendum. It was the correct thing to do to protect Newfoundland's interests, especially its power to negotiate terms for itself with Canada." So we were jubilant. We didn't think the UK government would go against the recommendations of the National Convention, which they themselves had set up. And we had all participated and gone through a year of this convention and its importance. England still had enormous prestige after the war. Not everyone trusted them, of course. The more Irish you were, and the more familiar with recent Irish history, the more unwilling you were to take anything the British said or did at face value. Trusting the English was not something the Irish could do. But we all got a shock. It's one thing to suspect something, and another to have it happen. So, when he gets the news, when they find out in Britain the news, the Dominions, the minister, the Dominions officer, Lord Addison, flips, and he says everything about the National Convention, and he said he talks about the results we desire, and that it was a foregone conclusion. This was a shock to them, but what they decide to do is ignore the National Convention completely, and put Confederation on the ballot paper. After secret talks with the Canadians. That the Canadians would accept that. And there's a furor in Newfoundland, but the British decide to brazen it out, saying that there's a large opposition wanted Confederation, so we think it only fair, and blah, 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 and they go on like this, right? But the Canadians start to get very nervous in Canada. In Ottawa, they're getting very nervous. And a big split develops now in the Canadian cabinet over this. On February 48, on the eve of the secret of more secret negotiations with Great Britain, a fierce battle erupted in Mackenzie King's cabinet over the procedure that they were taking. Norman Robertson demanded non-interference and argued forcefully against the inclusion of Confederation on the ballot paper. Mackenzie King himself supported this and recorded in his diary. Robertson pointed out quite emphatically what the Newfoundlanders should do is decide between responsible government and other government, and when they got responsible government, come and negotiate with us, the Canadians. That is the position I have taken from the beginning, he continues. However, Louis Saint-Laurent, was inclined to feel that all that had been done up to the present should not have been attempted if that was the view taken. In this, I think he is quite wrong, but I could see that Saint-Laurent was unwilling to let it go and do other than press the matter. Seeing this, I left the discussion to other members of the cabinet, particularly Wishart, Robertson, McCann, Pearson, and Abbott, all of whom thought it would be wrong of Canada to express any opinion on what Britain should do in Newfoundland. But then once the Prime Minister had quit the field, the decision belonged to Saint-Laurent and the powerful C.D. Howe, along with R.A. McKay and Jack Pickersgill and Scott MacDonald, all ardent supporters for acquiring Newfoundland and especially Labrador while they were still under British control. Jack Pickersgill, Mackenzie King's executive assistant, kept Mackenzie King buoyed along towards this more active policy in Newfoundland. Pickersgill believed that the whole future of Canada depended on Newfoundland, and that if the United States took over Newfoundland, reaching up into the east coast of Canada as Alaska was on the west, well, then Canada would be strangled physically and spiritually. And that's what Saint-Laurent thought, and that's what C.D. Howe thought. But C.D. Howe wanted to get his money on the hands on that iron ore in Labrador. C.D. Howe had received a secret report from Hollinger on the mother lode in Labrador. Now they needed a certain amount of iron ore to construct the St. Lawrence Seaway and to put the railway through. It had to be a certain amount. And so the report comes back from Hollinger. Yes, yes, it's that and more. So the Canadians are yes, yes, yes. And they get these guys again, and they say, don't tell the Newfoundlanders. Don't let the National Convention know that this, because this will give them a huge advantage in arguing for responsible government, and their own government back. So they keep it quiet. They don't tell anyone that this is going, that what the thing is. Well, Canada, if Canada could have gotten Labrador without Newfoundland, they would have done it like that. But they were afraid of the Americans. So then you have the bitter referendum fight. And in the end, the governor, the American proconsul, Wainwright, the American consul in St. John's, believes that the Confederation cannot win. Newfoundlanders are against it. And the British think the same thing. They've convinced themselves because of their penury that it will, and they're working for it, but they all think that it's going to be like razor thin, if at all. So after the vote, the first vote is inconclusive, even though responsible government wins, not enough votes. So they leave off commission of government, the British option, and it's just a runoff between Confederation and responsible government in the final. And Smallwood goes to Ches Crosby, head of the Union with America Party. And he says to Ches, I'll give you anything. You can be premier. Just stop fighting Confederation. You can be premier. And Ches says no. So then the fight goes on. He goes back to Ches and he says, I don't know who he's been talking to in the meantime, Joey. But he goes back to Ches and says, look, if you continue this fight, this is in. We're going to get Confederation. You're on the losing side here. And if you keep fighting for Confederation in the second runoff ballot, we will call all your loans in and bankrupt you. He was a big businessman in Newfoundland, very widely respected, very popular. So they got to Ches, other guys too, Jeff Sterling. And so they backed away from the fight in the second referendum. Others kept it up, but certain key figures backed away. So the second vote has been taken. It's very, very bitter. Smallwood is flying around the place in airplanes, calling in loudspeakers, talking about Confederation over villages. He's like, he uses biblical terms, the whole thing. This is the new, you know what I mean? It's amazing production. Canada pours in thousands and thousands of dollars. There's C.D. Howe setting Smallwood up with all his liquor outlets in Canada, and they pour in thousands of dollars. And it's just like it's a parade for Confederation right across the country. They buy agents for every polling station in the vote. Responsible government can't do that. In every polling station where there wasn't a responsible government agent, they lose. Where there's only a Confederation agent in they win. I had three people tell me after the book, yeah, so my father fought for Confederation. I used to go with him to the graveyard, and Dad would take names off the tombstones. And then we'd go and put them on the poll, on the roster, the voting roster, in Grand Falls. I said, you did? Yes, he said, I'm proud I did it too, because, did goof the flat. They took the votes away from their fellow Newfoundlanders. So it was a sham. And during this, the British are completely sweating it out. They all get together in London for special meetings, the Canadians and the British and the British government from Canada. they thought there was no chance for a majority. And so they're talking about who, if it's a really small majority, they say, well who's going to make the call? And Pearson was really sweating it. He didn't like the situation at all. And he writes this letter to Norman Robertson in London. Norman Robertson is now the Canadian High Commissioner in London. And Pearson says in secret, it would appear that in the event of a majority being too small to justify proceeding with Confederation, the United Kingdom would like to place full responsibility for the decision on the Canadian government. We should like, if possible, to avoid this, since it might well prejudice any later chance for Confederation. If you have an opportunity, would you please stress to the British that while we appreciate their view that Canada should have the deciding vote as to whether Newfoundland should be accepted in the event of a very small majority, we hope that if circumstances require that this course be taken, the United Kingdom will appreciate the desirability of at least endorsing Canada's position in the matter. End of quote. The Canadians required the backing of the United Kingdom to carry off this constitutional coup. Both empires would put their credibility on the line, hold their noses if need be, and sign off on the dotted line. On July 12th, Governor MacDonald returned back to St. John's from London from his secret meetings at the Dominion's office with Noel Baker, the new, anyway. And he drafted this dispatch. He received a dispatch from London, drafted by the head of the Dominion's office, Noel Baker, to confirm with the governor in St. John's that, quote, "The London meetings were designed to ensure as far as possible that you and I are in agreement as to the action which will have to be taken." This is days before the election, or the last vote. What action would the governor have to take other than count the votes and report the result? What action? Well, it seems Noel Baker thought the same thing, and they didn't send that telegram. That was in the files found in London. They sent another one, which was more mellowed out, right? But nevertheless, the governor knew what he was talking about. The following day, a nervous Governor Gordon MacDonald replied to Noel Baker in London, quote, "It would be advisable to have within a day's outing of St. John's a cruiser or destroyer. On Friday night, June 23rd, the day after the vote, we would need to know how to contact the ship to inform the commander as soon as possible as to whether it was necessary for him to sail into St. John's Harbor. I am sorry that I am unable to be more definite, but you know how difficult, especially as the whole matter has to be kept top secret." For the moment, at least, Governor MacDonald's accustomed bluster and air of invincibility wavered before the specter of the crowd's fury at the outcome he was to announce. He knew the outcome he was going to announce, and he knew it wasn't going to be popular. So, they have the vote, and it's a very razor-thin margin for Confederation. And the Canadians sit on that. They don't know what to do. Mackenzie King again says that I don't think we should be doing this. They're all up there saying we should. The vote's been taken. And so London writes to him and says, "Immediate, secret, personal, Prime Minister, I have today received a private letter from Gordon MacDonald in St. John's, your High Commissioner. He asked that this should be treated as a very private matter, of course, because he does not wish anyone in Newfoundland to know that he has written to me in this way. But it seems to me the result of the referendum will give Confederation at least 5,000 majority. I consider it a fine achievement. In my personal opinion, there is only one course for the Canadian authorities, namely to accept the decision and to ask for a delegation of authorized representatives be appointed, and to state that such a delegation would be received at an early date. There must be no hesitation on the part of the Canadian authorities. Any sign whatsoever of hesitation will be fatal." So they are sweating it to the end here. But Canada obliges, goes and accepts the result, and Confederation is and they don't even look to the National Convention for guys to go up and sign this thing. They pick seven people out of some of the private life, but they do pick Ches Crosby to go because he is the most prominent member of the opposition, and they have to make this thing look like they're trying to paper over the cracks in some way. He's the only anti-Confederate of the seven, and he's the only one who refuses to sign the terms. The Canadians sweat them out over the terms. It's a great chapter of how the Canadians and them negotiate the terms. It's like, but finally, Ches says, "No, I can't do it." He nearly has a nervous breakdown. He says, "No, he can't do it," and leaves Ottawa, comes home unsigned.
Well, which government is the more nefarious, in your opinion, the British or the
Britain? I suppose that's some relief for the Canadians. Well, I was heartened to see the divisions in both governments, and that it was not just a complete. The agreed-on thing, that there were a lot of people, and the debates in the British Parliament were very bitter sometimes over what was being done. It was considered a blot on British democracy that would never be forgotten, and all these kinds of things were said, you know. But, sorry, yeah.
And the question of Labrador, if it was known of all these ore deposits there, then how did Newfoundland end up
in 1927, that's right. They were
on where Labrador belonged.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. So but the That was a great court case too, and Newfoundland had a really good lawyer, and they concluded, they just reconfirmed the authority that Newfoundland was given over Labrador by George III, Mad King George. He gave Captain Graves jurisdiction of Newfoundland and Labrador from Blanc-Sablon to, you know, something, I forget the two things, and the height of land and the height of land and all this kind of stuff. The coast, it's called the coast of Labrador, but that was the way that it was done, though. They decided that no, the height of land means you go up to the mountains, and all the watershed that goes down to the coast belongs, just like Virginia and other, they're all described the same way in the terms, right? And so they said that was their authority given by George III to Newfoundland, and we have no authority to take that away. So Labrador has always belonged to Newfoundland, and so we are just reconfirming that. We're not deciding it, we're just reconfirming that. And Canada accepted it and changed their maps. Quebec didn't accept it and didn't change their maps, but over time they sort of did, right? But then with this deal, Britain was hoping to give it all back to Canada. Right. Yeah. I like to say, go ahead. I'd say they'd be a province of Canada, but on very different conditions and in a very much more and much nicer arrangement, much nicer feeling about the whole thing, you know. I think it would be the same outcome ultimately, but Newfoundland would have got its government back, would have realized that it's getting almost $1 billion a year from overfly rights because it's the flight path. Canada gets like $1 billion a year from Newfoundland from overflights alone. They would have realized they had the iron ore. They had all the resources they needed to be an independent country. They could have given their own, couldn't have given Newfoundlanders within like a 4 or 5 year period the whole full social welfare package that Canada had just taken from Sweden and offered it after the war. Canada had this social welfare package, so it all came in. Swedish model, Swedish people were already doing it. And that was a big inducement for Newfoundland to join. Or that was the whole campaign was that, was about the social welfare package, you know. But Newfoundland would have had the resources to do it if they'd realized the thing of the ore deposits.
Sort of in that same vein, do you think that it's too late for this to be rectified? Do you think where do you think Newfoundland could go with this information? Like, this is fantastic to have light brought to.
Yeah. Well, I think it would be good to, you know, to put an end to the myth of Canadian generosity and Newfoundland dependence and that whole awful, you know, thing. We can't afford to support Newfoundlanders down there on a rock collecting welfare attitude, as Stephen Harper said, right? Canada couldn't afford to let Newfoundland go. Newfoundland saved Canada, really, and the states backed off and let them in. But now that I think Canada could. Newfoundland could absolutely say the terms of union were never negotiated by Newfoundlanders. They were never signed by Newfoundlanders. No government signed. They're the unilateral terms of occupation of a foreign power, basically. Britain gave them carte blanche. Britain wasn't interested in the terms. Any terms would do Britain. They just wanted out. And they were the principal in the negotiations. That was completely wrong setup. So the terms of Confederation are meaningless legally. And should be revisited for Newfoundland, and if any Newfoundland government wishes to do so, here is the authority to do it. You know, thank you very much. They can go for independence if they want. You know, if Canada falls apart, what are you going to do? You know, maybe we'll. What Ontario has given us Stephen Harper 3 times. Atlantic Canada didn't vote for him. Quebec didn't vote for him. Maybe we'll all separate Quebec and Atlantic Canada and become our own kind of left-wing kind of place, and they can keep Harper in Ontario and Alberta. Kath?
It makes me nostalgic for the idea that individuals in government had so much integrity that they could split off and they could, you know, like both in Britain and in Canada, members of parliament, because you don't have individualism.
No.
You couldn't split apart like that.
That's right. There seems to be a lot more independence of thought and in those days.
Yeah.
And more freedom to speak.
Yes.
You know, really, yeah. Yeah, because,
You wouldn't have people doing that now. If you're a liberal, you can't speak with the authority.
No. And you never hear anyone in Harper's government speaking up and saying anything. Yeah. But the post-war settlement of Newfoundland is like, I like to say, Russia got Poland, Canada got Newfoundland. Right? They both had a Joe S. There was Joe Sal and Joe Smallwood. They both had preposterous five-year industrialization schemes. They both had big resettlement programs. And they were both humiliated by what had happened to them. The Polish joke and the Newfoundland joke are the same joke, just with different names, right? Oh, you lost your country. You're stupid Polak, you're stupid Newfie, you're stupid, you know, this is all. So we suffered that for about, it took 50 years for Poland to crawl out from under that, with Lech Wałęsa and the crowd, and a cultural revolution of their own. Same thing for Newfoundland. It wasn't until the 80s that Newfoundland started to crawl out from that. 70s, really, and 80s, with their own cultural revolution and taking back the democracy. But Britain destroyed democracy in Newfoundland in 1933. That was followed by 21 years of elected dictatorship under Smallwood. That's what those 17 years of dictatorship set us up for more dictatorship. You just don't get your democracy back and everything works like, you know, it's all rusted and in the mud. So Britain really destroyed a lot more in Newfoundland than what appears at the outset. And it wasn't really till you get like Frank Moores and much later and CODCO and Frank Moores and Newfoundland starts to fight back, basically, psychologically, emotionally, and politically, and regain its self-esteem and its sanity, you know. But and it took 50 years to get out of there. But politically deafening silence. You know? These people are all people who made their deals with Canadians. The ones like, Ed Roberts, who reviewed my book. His father made a big deal with Joey, and he was the drug guy in Newfoundland, the drug czar, basically, in Newfoundland. And everyone had made their, they bought their senatorships, $25,000, you got your senatorship, and everything, you know, everyone got paid off. And there's always enough quislings around to get paid off.
Was this basically open secret in Newfoundland?
Yes. People knew it in Newfoundland, but they couldn't prove it. That's right. In the National Convention, when they came back from London, Peter Cashin stood up and said, there is a conspiracy. He said, he said there's a conspiracy to sell our island to Canada. I'm Britain, you know, and it's going to happen. He said, we're treated with the cultural, watch when we go to Ottawa now. He said, the joy bells will ring out, and sure enough, they did. He said it all, and he couldn't prove it. And so he was destroyed by it, you know what I mean, and so many others were, that... That's why, for the sake of sanity, it's good to have the truth out. Doesn't matter how late it comes out. It's.
Where was Joey in all of the pre-negotiations and that?
Joey was a political guy. Joey. Joey thought that what was good for Joey was good for Newfoundland, and that's dangerous thinking, right? You know, whatever's good. Joey worked with the. He was a poor guy. They were farmers from PEI. Hey, his family. He didn't like the fishery. He didn't like fish at all, and he never did get used to the fishery. And that's why the fishery suffered under Joey tremendously. But he worked for Squires in the 20s, and learned his political craft from him. And then when the Commissioner of Government took over, he went off to New York and became a socialist. And he.
Three times. Atlantic Canada didn't vote for him, Quebec didn't vote for him. Maybe we'll all separate Quebec and Atlantic Canada and become our own kind of left-wing kind of place, and we can keep power in Ontario and Alberta. Kat?
It makes me nostalgic for the idea that individuals in government had so much integrity that they could split off and they could, both in Britain and in Canada, members of parliament had in like now under Harper, people just they have to toe the party line.
Yeah.
They don't have individualism.
No.
They couldn't split apart like that.
That's right. There seems to be a lot more independence of thought and in those days.
Yeah, you were
and
actually
more freedom.
To take, yes.
You know? Yeah. Yeah, because.
Like you couldn't have people doing that now. If you're a liberal, you can't split within the party and have different opinions.
And you never hear anyone in Harper's Town speaking out, saying anything. But the post-war settlement of Newfoundland is like, I like to say, Russia got Poland, Canada got Newfoundland. They both had a Joe West, there was Joe Sal and Joe Smallwood. They both had preposterous 5-year industrialization schemes. They both had big resettlement programs. And they were both humiliated by what had happened to them. The Polish Joe and the Newfoundland joke are the same joke, just with different names, right?
Sure.
Oh, you lost your country, you're stupid Polak, you stupid Newfie, you're stupid, you know, this is all. So we suffered that for about, took 50 years for Poland to crawl out from under that, with Lech Wałęsa and the crowd, and a cultural evolution of their own. Same thing for Newfoundland. It wasn't until the 80s that Newfoundland started to crawl out from that, 70s really, and 80s, with their own cultural revolution, and taking back the country. But Britain destroyed democracy in Newfoundland in 1933. That was followed by 21 years of elected dictatorship under Smallwood. That's what those 17 years of dictatorship set us up for more dictatorship. You just don't get your democracy back and everything works. Like, you know, it's all rusted in the mud. So Britain really destroyed a lot more in Newfoundland than what appears at the outset. And it wasn't really till, you know, you get like Frank Moore's and much later, and, you know, CODCO and Frank Moore's. Newfoundland starts to fight back. Basically, psychologically, emotionally, and politically, and regain its self-esteem and its sanity, you know. But it took 50 years to get out of there.
What has been the reaction politically to your book?
But politically deafening silence. You know, these people are all people who made their deals with Canadians. So like, you know what I mean? Like the ones like Ed Roberts, who reviewed my book. His father made a big deal with Joey, and he was the drug guy in Newfoundland, the drug czar basically in Newfoundland. And everyone had made they bought their senatorships, $25,000, you got your senatorship, and everything, you know, everyone got paid off. There's always enough quislings around to get paid off.
Was this basically an open secret in Newfoundland?
Yes. People knew it in Newfoundland, but they couldn't prove it.
Until the papers were...
That's right, at the National Convention, when they came back from London, Peter Cashin stood up and said, there's a conspiracy. He said, there's a conspiracy to sell our island to Canada. I'm Britain, you know, and it's going to happen. He said, you know, we're treated with cold shoulder. Watch when we go to Ottawa now. He said, the joy bells will ring out. And sure enough, they did. He said it all and couldn't prove it. And so he was destroyed by it, you know what I mean? And so many others were. That's why, for the sake of sanity, it's good to have the truth out. It doesn't matter how late it comes out. It's
Where was Joey in all of the pre-negotiations?
Joey was
how did he rise to the top?
Joey thought what was good for Joey was good for Newfoundland, and that's dangerous thinking, right? You know? Joey worked with the, he was a poor guy. They were farmers from PEI, okay, his family. He didn't like the fishery, he didn't like fish at all, and he never did get used to the fishery, and that's why the fishery suffered under Joey tremendously. But he worked for Squires in the 20s and learned his political preferring. And then when the commissioner government took over, he went off to New York and became a socialist. And
he worked at politics in New York. And they used to send Joey to the Bowery and the Bronx and those places to speak to black audiences because Joey was colorblind, like most Newfoundlanders. He hadn't had that history, and he was going in there talking to them just like he was one of them. And they thought, sheesh, who's this white guy coming in here talking to us, right? Like, you know? But he went and listened to all the fundamentalist preachers and the politicians, you know, that hectoring style and repeating. And he got that. He learned everything in New York. And he was very popular as a speaker with this Socialist Party going around, fighting for the president. They were on one person's side, but their presidential candidate, I forget who it was, didn't win. And afterwards, he came back when he heard this news at the National Convention and that the British were finally going to do something constitutional, he thought, whoever puts, if I'm able to get Newfoundland Confederation, I'll be a hero. I'll be a great man. If I can be that guy, which others are unwilling to do, then I will be a hero. So he comes back to Newfoundland. He's actually back in Newfoundland by that point, before that. But he has a very successful radio show, The Barrel Man. And it's the first paycheck he's ever gotten. He's had an unsuccessful pig farm. He's a very unsuccessful guy. But he's got a big paycheck with The Barrel. He quits it, goes out to Gander. Canadian government hires him. And he's out in Gander just in time to run for the National Convention. He has to be there 2 years. He's just there 2 years. How wonderful. What a coincidence. He's in cahoots with Scott MacDonald. The Canadian High Commissioner has picked him up early, and that is those two are working in concert. They those two arrange the whole thing. Scott MacDonald puts him out there, and he becomes his agent. And Joey introduces Confederation into the National Assembly. He can't run in St. John's because he would never be elected. But he runs out there where he used to work and where he's got fame from the Barrel Man because it was very popular around the bay and stuff like that, right? So that's why he had to go to Gander to get elected. And that's why he went to Gander, became a pig farmer. And while he was in Gander, he took flights to Ottawa all the time, learning all about the Confederation and Canadian political system. And so he was ready on the ground when the National Convention came in. And whether they told Joe that, now the vote was fixed. The real result was a very slim majority for a responsible government. And so they didn't feel too bad having to change it, nudge it over the other line for Confederation. They hadn't come that far to lose it. They would have been horrified to lose the Newfoundland to the States. Would have been a disaster for Canada and a horrible humiliation for Britain. It could not be allowed to happen. And Roosevelt didn't want it to happen. They were all together on this. And they were told, and they went over, this is how the vote's going to be, the agents from the Dominion's office. And they said, well, how can this be? And they said, well, it's an agreement made between Churchill and Roosevelt. And this is why. And this is where it has to be. And so they were very nervous it would be a big split, but it was only a small majority for responsible government. So they just nudged it over the line. The whole voting process was controlled by the governor's office. No one, he counted the votes and he announced the results. And there was no safeguard, there was no other thing. So he could say whatever he wanted, basically. The only one who knew was Nehemiah Short, the polling officer.
And wasn't the ballot manipulated so that Newfoundlanders in their vulnerable state, feeling impoverished, kind of had the wording?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. They said responsible government as it existed in 1933, like in the middle of the, so to conjure up the image of the Depression, right? Not as it existed in 1910 when we were prosperous, 1933, commissioner of government for another 5 years, so that's got a short term, and then you got to go at it again, or confederation with Canada, just free and clear, like there was no conditions on that at all. All the others had conditions, and they were like, but. But they did, they nudged over that vote for Confederation. And that's why they were all sweating it and so hard, and they wanted the gumboat in and all this kind of stuff. The action that he would have to take, that's the action he would have to take, and that's the action he did take. He was hated in St. John's, the governor. And, he was almost run out of town, basically, for his part in the thing. They were afraid for their lives, the governor and his wife, in the government house. They were terrified there during the vote. But there it is.
What happened to all the rights the Americans had to Newfoundland after Confederation? Did they automatically go to
Canada? No, they stayed. They were there till 60 or 70. Some of the bases didn't close till quite late, yeah. But they gave up their lease and stuff eventually, yeah. Like Nehemiah Short, the returning officer, is a very interesting story of him. He, one of the students from Munn, who was doing a paper on this some years ago, a graduate student, had an interview. He went to Nehemiah Short's wife. Nehemiah Short, first of all, 5,000 ballots were burned, hey? There's a guy, David Butler, who was later a member of government. The commissioner of government called him up and said, David, you got to take these ballots down to the hospital, general hospital, and burn them in the furnace there, because they had a big furnace. And he was nervous about that, burning ballots. So he knew Nehemiah Short, the returning officers, who called Nehemiah Short and said, Nehemiah, Pottle here at the commission is telling me to take ballots down and burn them. What should I do? And he said, the vote, he said, was conducted neither worthily nor well. Burn them. Neither worthily nor well. Everyone I've ever talked to about that vote is like, everyone agrees it was a shabby, horrible event. Not at all proper democratic thing. Gwynne Dyer, you know Gwynne Dyer, his father was a big civil servant in the government. And he said, there was a cloud, he said, hung over my father his whole adult life. You could not mention the vote. You couldn't. He would just get so depressed and angry. So he said, that was the atmosphere, political atmosphere, among the Newfoundlanders who knew any, and the librarian at the legislative library, she said, everyone who knew anything knew that it was fixed. We all knew that. Anyone who had any contact with Government House knew that.
Those ballots that were burned, were they counted?
Were they, that was the size of the victory. It was a 5,000 vote victory. It was 5,000 votes burned. There were 5,000 responsible government votes burned to make that victory happen. You know. So that's the story of Newfoundland's confederation with Canada, my dear friends. I mean, there's lots of other little anecdotal stuff too that you know, I left all the anecdotal stuff for the end. It not documented, but these are, you know, stories from interviews of people who knew or who would know or interesting people and the whole kind of popular history and people of what really happened. I include at the end, you know, of all the documents. Joey. I've done Joey many times, yeah. Oh my God. Poor majority. So what does Jim say? Jim says nice at the very end. He laments how we lost everything. And he says, if you permit yourself to examine the truth for a moment, you have to consider that responsible government did actually win. Newfoundlanders voted for responsible government and for independence in 48. If you start with that realization, everything looks very different. Responsible government won in spite of limitless funds from Canada and the high-pressure tactics and schemes of Great Britain. From the announcement of the elections for the National Convention in December of 45 to the final vote in July of 48, it took the UK government almost 3 years to deliver on constitutional obligations, which had already been delayed by years. It took that long to wear down the Newfoundlanders into accepting Confederation and hopefully achieve the maximum conditions for a win. In spite of all that, responsible government won by a very slim majority, an astonishing achievement for a small but plucky nation. We did well in 48. It was the British and the Canadians who let their end down. And that's that. Well, thank you all. That was a good romp through history. Thanks. Great to see so many people interested. Yeah. Really any more questions I'll take too, yeah.
I love your talk, and I'm just wondering with what you've learned, have you been inspired to possibly be in the political side?
No, I don't think I have the temperament.
I think you'd be great. I would vote for you.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
I can't wait to talk to my British friends about
it. The British people, I've given it to several British people, quite educated, and you know, they loved it.
Yeah.
They thought it was a page turner. They couldn't believe it. They'd never heard of it. Because all familiar characters, all these, like Neville Chamberlain, all these, and you never hear of them doing this, right? You know, so it's a great shadow side of history, really.
Have you looked at Prowse's history of Newfoundland?
Yes.
And how did that, what he wrote, compare to the attitude of the British towards Newfoundland? It seemed to me that he wrote a pretty factual history.
Yeah. Prowse's history is pretty authoritative, and it's the one everyone goes back to Prowse at some point. Yeah, yeah.
But it was a very good
yes. Newfoundland in the North Atlantic World by Peter Neary is a fabulous book. Fabulous book about this, about the American, about the whole run of this same period, basically. And he gives all kinds of other great details that I haven't been able to get into, because I had to confine my argument. I wanted to confine this to the British and Canadian argument and try to get this clean as possible. But I use his book a lot. As far as history books goes, him and McClintock and Judge Prowse, when I wasn't mostly, of course, his documents, but that. But I found Neary really good. If you're looking for some further reading on this, I suggest him. Yeah, he's great, great.
I see another. He must have had an incredible editor, because I mean, I just had a quick look other than pictures.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you've got a very solid appendix there. You've got.
Yeah.
I had.
I know.
You had a really good editor.
I did, and I wanted to keep it.
So
yeah.
What
yeah.
To
yeah. And I wanted to keep. Well, it's about 4 years writing it. And I had a very good editor in Rosemary Shipton in Random House and Jane McQuinney. They were very good. And they would take every document I had and they would go to original source and they would find the document or whatever I was saying and they would check it word for word. So everything I had was checked by two people that it was authoritative, right? So that was really good for me. And they found a couple of mistakes that I had made in, you know, transcribing. And so they saved me. They hit my ass a couple of times. They were good. But basically the form I had, they suggested some leave out this, add this. And I did sometimes, but, you know, but I found them very good, though. They were really helpful.
You mentioned the first transatlantic flight. We were in Botwood this summer, and there was... there's an airplane there, I guess. Is that a Spitfire? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
It's like a little storm.
I don't know what airplane it is. I can't remember.
There's a gazebo.
Yeah.
And I was just reading. I just finished reading this thing about Charles Lindbergh.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
How he had this out-of-body experience in the 22nd hour of his flight during his first transatlantic flight.
Right.
And I think it said 38, but I thought you said 19.
Lindbergh was in Newfoundland in 33. And he scouted Newfoundland for airport sites. He picked Botwood and he picked a bunch of them for Pan Am.
So it didn't go from there? Because I thought it said that was the site of the first transatlantic flight.
It was in 1919, the first actual hop. But they were looking for commercial routes by the 30s. By the 30s, they had the kinks ironed out and they were looking for commercial routes that they could capitalize on. It was, you know.
It was really neat. I was reading this book and then I end up there with the same person.
Yes.
I was waiting for the experience.
Yeah. I had a lot of great coincidences coming from the book, from Britain and other places too. It's a lot of fun when you reach out there. Well, folks, that was fun. Thank you. I'll gladly autograph any book that you have. Yes, sure I will.
Can we read it now?
Oh yeah, I hope you enjoy it.
Say something like "Eyes Dubai" or something.
you to anyone or just?
You can make it out to me. I'm Bernadette.
Berna.
Bernadette. Yeah.